To represent graphs in this course, you'll be using an adjacency list. What that means is that for every vertex in the graph, you'll store a list of its outgoing edges. The vertices at the destinations of those edges are adjacent to the original vertex. Have a look at this graph. It represents a network of cities connected via airplane flight. This is the same graph represented as an adjacency list. Each visualization has its benefits. The adjacency list is particularly good for comparing the number of connections. Detroit has the fewest and Tokyo the most. But for our purposes, adjacency lists are useful because they can be represented using more fundamental data structures. We'll use a dictionary of arrays.
Creating a graph in code can be cumbersome and not very exciting. So for this episode, we've created a test file for you to start off with. It won't compile, for now, but you'll fix that. This multi-line literal that you see here is how we'll represent an adjacency list as a string. And this commented out code, which was also cumbersome to write, is how the string will be assembled. So, by now, you're surely assuming that an adjacency list is going to be a generic type. It's going to need edges and vertices, and you can copy the necessary type aliases over from graph. But what are elements' requirements?
Well, the dictionary of arrays I mentioned is going to use vertex as its key type. And so, as the compiler is complaining at you, element needs to be hashable. With that all set, adopt your graph protocol and let Xcode stub out the requirements. It won't do a perfect job, but it'll save you some work. The graph's vertices are the keys of the adjacencies dictionary. When adding a vertex, it will become a new key in the adjacencies dictionary, which means that its index should be the count of vertices already in the dictionary. To start off with, it won't have any adjacencies. Xcode doesn't propagate @discardableResult mutating from the protocol, so you'll need to type that yourself to be able to mutate adjacencies. Getting the edges connected to a vertex is just a dictionary lookup.
Now is the time to create a way to add edges to your adjacency list. For a directed graph, that would be simple. An edge stores a source and destination vertex. You just add it to the source vertex's collection. But we're only working with undirected graphs in this course, so how will you represent an undirected edge between two vertices? Well, remember that an undirected graph can be viewed as a bidirectional graph, where every edge can be traversed in both directions. When you're supplied with an edge, add it to the adjacencies for the edge's source. Then create a reversed version of that edge. And add that to the adjacencies for the original edge's destination. Now you've got a bidirectional, or undirected, edge.
You're also done working on the adjacency list. So you can uncomment this extension and have a look at the test case. The adjacency list that we've created in the test represents this graph. There are 8 different airports, so we'd expect to see vertex indices from 0 to 7. Also, there's a weight for each edge, the price for a plane ticket. That price for this undirected graph is the same flying in either direction. We start off with a mutable adjacency list. Then we add vertices to the graph. The stored return values of those add vertex calls hold the indices of the vertices in the graph. With that data, we create one edge for every connecting flight. When adding an edge in one direction, an opposite edge gets added too. Running the test, we'll see that this string is the description for the graph.
The adjacency list is the only graph representation you'll be using in this course, but you should be aware of a related solution called an adjacency matrix. It uses a square two-dimensional array instead of a dictionary of arrays. More details can be found in our book, but have a look at this performance chart for a comparison with the adjacency list you're now familiar with. V represents vertices here, and E is for edges. If your graph has lots of edges, an adjacency matrix might be a better fit. It's tuned for accessing weights and edges far more quickly. But if your graph's edges are sparse, like they are in the examples we're using in this course, an adjacency list is a good choice. An adjacency matrix would use more memory for no benefit. Next, we'll finish off with a challenge on graphs, and then start using graphs to power some algorithms.
We have lots of videos covering algorithms and a whole bunch of other videos covering a whole wealth of subjects. So definitely swing on by raywunderlich.com and give us a hello in the forums. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.